In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, the sun and the moon. He created all living things, and he said, "It is good." And it was good until sin entered the garden. Mankind had been corrupted. Evil had filled their hearts. God chose one man and his family to start over.
Guys, so this week we're going to continue our journey through the life of Noah, and we certainly hope that you've enjoyed that experience so far and all that God is doing through that. And today what I hope is, as we dive into the actual flood event itself, that you will get a better understanding of who God is. I hope you leave today with a greater appreciation for God's Word and the Bible and Scripture. And I hope that it'll be life-changing, as always. We never teach the Bible at Three Circle to just get smart and be smarter theologians. We teach the Bible to know God more and to have our lives transformed. And today I believe that can happen. We've been talking about Noah, this ancient story, 1,500 years into the story of humanity is when this happened. And so many of us know a little bit about the story, but we kind of left it behind, like it's a kid's story, and we really couldn't get much out of it, so we've moved on, and there's not a lot of teaching on it, but we decided we wanted to dive into it because we believe God wanted us to know it, and Noah, get it, that's kind of funny, so we're going to dive in today and learn a lot more about that. Now, first of all, I want to talk about the nature of Scripture, the nature of the Bible, okay, because many of you came in today, and you like the church thing's okay for you, but sometimes I think we believe that you have to be stupid to believe the Bible, really. Like, do we really believe that this happened? Do we really believe, or is this just a cute little story that was people made up along the way so that we can understand God? Or did this really happen? And we do believe that it really happened, and I want to show you why today. But the first reason we believe it happened, and I believe it's important that we grab onto this today, is that we believe the Bible. The reason we do is 2 Timothy 3:16 tells us what the Bible is and the nature of Scripture. It says, all Scripture is God-breathed, or in other words, inspired. God-breathed, or God-written, and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness. There we see the nature of the Bible and the purpose of the Bible. The purpose of the Bible was not just to inform you, it was to change you, it was to change us from the inside out, but it came from God. So write this down. The big idea is we can and we should trust God's Word. Now, we can. I'm going to show you today that I believe the Bible is trustworthy, and we should trust it. Now, I'm a parent, and if I tell my kids to not do something and they do it anyway, it means they didn't believe me. They didn't trust my word. And how many of you know that it is important, it's imperative for a child to trust his parent's word because the parent knows more than the kid does, right? I mean, as my kids grow up, I knew that things were hot before my kids knew they were hot. How many of you know that when I tell them to not touch it, they need to not touch it, even if they don't understand why? Daddy understands more. I need them to believe me. We used to live on a busy street before we moved here to the Eastern Shore, and we told our kids, don't go out that front door and run towards the street. If you do, you're going to be run over. It could take your life. Don't do it. And we had to over and over again get them to trust us, that even if they didn't understand why we were telling them not to do something, we knew more. Now that is, it's almost hard to measure how much more important it is for us to trust God's Word. He knows more than we know, and we need to get to a point and wrestle down today. Do I believe the Bible? Do I trust God's Word? And I believe you can and that you should trust God's Word. Interestingly enough, Humanity came off the rails. This whole thing, humanity came to its knees over this issue of trusting God's word. Let's go back to the creation account. Genesis chapter 2 tells us that God gave Adam his word. It says this, "And the Lord God commanded the man, 'You are free to eat from any tree in the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, for when you eat it, you will certainly die.'" Now that's a warning, and that's command, that's freedom, all of it wrapped into one. It's God giving his word. And what we see here is that God even says, if you don't do it, it's going to destroy you. If you don't do it, it's going to destroy that inner part of you that makes you who you are. Your body will still be there, but your heart's going to die the moment you disobey me. And they didn't trust him. In fact, the full frontal attack from Satan, and we're about to read it, came to this area, this important, crucial part of our relationship with God. Do we trust his word? Write it down. God gave Adam and Eve a choice. They had a choice. Do we trust God or not? Do I believe it or not? I believe that's our choice today. Do we believe this or not? It's imperative that we decide whether or not we believe. And we see the attack from Satan. Now, this is interesting because we think, I think our perception is that Satan was constantly attacking humanity, and he does in many ways, but this is the most out-in-the-open attack, and he really doesn't do it like this again. We don't hear from him a lot more in Scripture, right? We see him come and tempt Jesus in the wilderness, but we don't see this full frontal attack like we get in the garden. And I believe it's because he didn't have to again like this. It only took one time, and it brought humanity to its knees. And look what the Bible says. The serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God had made. The reason he was more crafty is because he had been possessed and taken over by the devil. And the serpent said to the woman, "Did God really..." Now look what he said. Here's the attack. It's just one statement. One question. Did God really say you must not eat from the tree in the garden? Do you see that? The first attack on humanity was, did he really say it? Is that really true? Is the Bible really true? Can you really trust God's word? And it was a lethal attack. It brought humanity to its knees. You're still feeling the effects today. The reason you have to teach your kids not to lie and not to steal and not to throw stuff at one another and not to scream at you is because they were born sinners. And the reason is Satan got our original parents to mistrust God and not believe his word. And the consequences were deadly. Write this down. Satan's lethal attack on humanity was to convince them to question God's word. Jesus told us how important it is to trust the word. In Luke 11:28, Jesus said, "Blessed are those who hear the word of God and obey it." Now, this is important because my trust is what takes me from being a hearer to being an obeyer of the word. Trust is the difference between the two. It puts the two together because any of us can hear the word, right? It's important that you hear it, but that's not only what needs to happen. The Bible says don't just be hearers of the word, be doers of the word, or in other words, be obedient. And Jesus said, blessed is not just the person who hears it, because let's be honest, there's churches all over the Eastern Shore, you just about couldn't throw a rock and not hit one, right? If you want to hear the word of God preached, you can hear it. We've even made it easy on you now. You can stay in your pajamas and drink coffee and watch it online, right? You can turn it on TV 24/7, you can hear the Bible in some form. Now, I would warn you, sometimes it's not in a good way, okay? But it's there, all right? But yet we don't, and yet we mistrust so often the Bible that it keeps us, we stay hearers, but we don't become doers. Jesus said, blessed are those who hear it and obey it. And I'm telling you, the thing that moves us from being hearers to obedient to the word is trust. Because if I believe God means what he says, and I believe this book is real, I'll obey it. If I think this is for my good and that it's not just some good story, then I'll actually do what it says it'll do, and it'll actually change my life. So what do we believe about the Bible at Three Circle Church? A few things. Number one, we believe the Bible is inerrant and inspired. Inerrant and inspired. Very important here. Inspired, God breathed. We believe that God wrote the Bible, and he did it through human beings, through human intellect, through human personality, through human hands. A physical representation of what inspiration looks like is that the hand of men over an unbelievable amount of time was covered by the hand of the Holy Spirit, the hand of God, and they were led to write in their personality, in their time, in their context. It is amazing. The Bible is unbelievable in the way it interlocks, in the way it complements, never doing this, always doing this. I'm telling you, the Bible is amazing, and we believe that it is inspired, God breathed, and we also believe that it's inerrant, which means we believe it's true. We believe that what's in the Bible is true. The Bible doesn't tell you everything, but what it does tell you is true. And we have a mountain of evidence that teaches us this. The Bible has stood the test of time. The Bible has stood the test of critique. And anytime science thought that it had a way to bring the Bible down, it just kept standing there. There's an example of a time when they found an old copy of the book of Isaiah. Now, many intellectuals criticized the Bible for a long time because they said Isaiah, that there's no way the prophetic book of Isaiah could be really true because it just predicts all the things about Jesus too perfectly. So they critiqued and they said what happened was people after Jesus lived went back in and rewrote Isaiah and wrote all that stuff in. Now, this was an attack for a long time. And then they found this little thing called the Dead Sea Scrolls. And it had a really old copy of the book of Isaiah. And many critics said, we got you now. Where did they get those things out of there? And we'll just take a modern version of the Bible, we'll lay it next to Isaiah, and you'll see that someone messed with that and they will not line up. Except they did. 98.7% accuracy between the old scrolls and what you hold in your hands right now. You say, well, what's that couple of percent? What's that? Nothing that changes the meaning of anything. It was this. Let's just say you were a scribe and you were doing your thing. You were so careful to get it right and someone sneezed and you did this because it scared you, right? And you put a mark on there or you put a dot where it shouldn't have been. We're talking scribal error. That's it. I don't want to get too deep into that. Here's the big idea that I want you to get. You can believe the Bible. If you went to a university, you read things like Homer's Odyssey, the Gilgamesh, things like that, and they told you all this evidence that they have of the accuracy of the literature that you were reading, the Bible literally body slams those documents with what we have. The evidence, the old evidence, the manuscripts, the science backs it up. When you hold a Bible in your hand, you can read it and you can trust it, okay? And you don't have to be an idiot and crazy and a redneck to believe the Bible, okay? Because I know that's what the world thinks, right? You ever watch the news and you think they think we are all crazy and stupid? But I want to make a case today that you don't have to lose your brain to believe the Bible. In fact, I'm pretty sure people are laying aside big chunks of their brains to not believe it. That's how believable I believe the Bible really is. We believe that everything in it is true. The history that is in it is true. Now, here's the deal. Just grab onto this. We are not afraid of science at Three Circle Church. Science is not the enemy. We love science. I'm happy about medical care. I'm happy about dental care. Okay? I'm glad someone discovered that. The Bible does not tell you how to fix a cavity on a tooth. Someone else discovered that, and that was truth when they discovered it. So let me just tell you our approach to this here at Three Circle, and I believe it's a biblical approach. Where science offers truth, we affirm it, embrace it, and celebrate it. How many of you are happy you have good doctors in America, right? That use their gifts? Yeah. Okay, that's a good thing. Science is awesome. Science isn't the enemy. We don't check our brains at the door. We believe that God allowed people with great talent. We have people in the medical profession and in the scientific world sitting in seats right now. And we affirm that gift and we believe it's a calling just like the one I'm fulfilling standing behind this pulpit. Okay, and I believe that people minister through medicine. And I believe that God has blessed us with that. But where science contradicts God's word, we challenge it. Okay? We affirm it where it gives us truth, because the Bible's not exhaustive. The Bible doesn't tell me many medical things that he has allowed scientists to find, and we embrace that truth. But where science contradicts the Word of God, okay, we don't affirm that, we challenge it. In the case of creation, in the case of the story of the flood, we see that, and in fact, oftentimes what we see is that science actually backs us up with the Word of God. So I want you to understand that today. I want you to get, because we want to be thoughtful. I think, sadly, in modern Christianity, so oftentimes, and in particular, unfortunately, as much as I love it, in Southern Christianity, we tend to not be very thoughtful. We tend to throw out arguments like, well, I don't get it, but the Bible says it. And my granddad read the Bible. Right? And Roll Tide. Okay? And that's not going to help us. That's not going to help us win any hearts to Jesus, okay? Just so you know. Okay, let's be thoughtful. Let's be nuanced. Let's think. Think, and use your mind. Jesus said, love the Lord your God while your heart, soul, and... Okay? We believe this. The Bible was written by the one true God to reveal himself to humanity. There was a reason behind it. The reason all of science isn't held in the Bible is because the Bible's not a science book. But the science that is within the Bible is true and has been proven to be. And I could give you a long list of this, but let me just give you a few. Like, for instance, the hygiene rules that God gave the people of Israel have stood the test of time. And later on, we figured out, oh, I see why he was doing that. He was helping them stay well. It was ahead of its time. Science caught up with the Bible. A theology professor I knew once used to love to say that scientists keep climbing mountains and they get to the top and find all the theologians hanging out around a campfire waiting for them to get there. Did you know that the Bible taught in the Old Testament that the earth was round? Yet everyone thought it was flat for a long time. They should have had their quiet time and a devotional and read the Bible. Would have saved them thousands of years of incorrect belief about geography. Listen, the science that is in the Bible is true, but it's not all scientific. The history is true. It's not all historical, though. The Bible was written to reveal God. He was revealing himself to us, and that which is held within the Bible is true. And here's the deal. Not only is it true, it's relevant. All relevant truth begins in the Bible. For instance, I could tell you something that's true, but it's not relevant. Like my dog Jasper, he's black and white. Who cares? That's not relevant, right? Cool. Glad you got a black and white dog. Doesn't matter to me a bit. So the Bible's not just true. The Bible's true and relevant, which means you need what it says. It has a purpose. You need everything, including the story of Noah, which is why we teach the Bible. Okay, I'm going to keep teaching the Bible as long as I'm on this planet. I'm going to be an old man still teaching the Bible. Okay? Because we need it. God meant it for a purpose and has revealed himself through the Word. Every single bit of the Bible was written to reveal God. And that all leads us to this point. The biblical account of the flood is a true depiction of an actual event in human history. It is not myth. And here's why. Because Genesis clearly tells you that it is a historical book. It tells you, here's what happened. It gives you tons of detail. Here at Three Circle, we use an interesting approach to Scripture. We use what we'll call the historical, grammatical, literal approach to Scripture. Okay? I've been trained in that approach, and I believe that it's a good approach. And of course, I believe it's the right approach. And I'm not mad at people that don't use it. I'm totally comfortable with people being wrong, okay? I just believe, and have been taught, and many others, that we should read the Bible as it is. How many of you think that God knew what he was doing when he wrote the Bible, when he gave us the Word? He knew he was revealing himself to humans, so he used human language, okay? He came in the form of Jesus to reveal himself to us. So why in the world would he make us have to have all this guesswork? Which is why we go literal, historical, grammatical. We believe the Bible can be read the way it is. It's not, we don't have to read stuff into it. Well, the Bible says here, there is a vine and a leaf and a wind blowing with water beneath. Wonder what that means. It means there's a vine and a leaf and there's some water underneath it. That's what it means. If it's in a book like Genesis, which is historical. If it's in Revelations, Revelations clearly tells you this is a vision, this is symbolic, we're going to do some symbolism. Just watch, the Bible will tell you where it's going. Proverbs, to giving you some wise sayings here. Ecclesiastes, I'm kind of grumpy, I'm looking back on my life, but I'm also going to give you some more sayings. The Bible tells you where it's going. Genesis, clearly historical narrative. That's why we don't believe Noah is some story someone made up to reveal God to you. And by the way, why all the details? If you're going to just tell a cute story, why all the details? Why tell me how big the boat is? Why tell me the exact month and day as you're about to see that the flood started? The historicity of the narrative of the Noah story in Genesis is upheld and affirmed by the detail that is there. You don't give that many details to just a cute little kid's story. And that's not what it was. So now with all that, let's take a look. Genesis 7, 6 through 12. Noah was 600 years old when the floodwaters came on the earth. Why? Remember what we said. The earth was a different environment. How did he live 600 years? Which is old, right? How did he do that? Because the earth was a different environment, surrounded by a water layer, mysteriously talked about in Genesis as the firmament, and we never see it talked about again in the Bible. It's because it collapsed on the earth during the flood, which is how God flooded the earth, okay? And because it was that kind of environment, there weren't weather systems. There probably wasn't wind. There was no tornadoes and hurricanes. There wasn't deserts. There wasn't polar ice caps. The earth was a different environment pre-flood. So different than you and I can hardly even grab onto it. Okay? And there's tons of evidence that points to this. Tons of it. Now, I understand you might not believe it. I'm not telling you you have to believe the way I believe. I just want you to know that I didn't fall off the back of some truck yesterday to believe what I believe. Science affirms so much of this, and the Scriptures teach it. Verse 8, pairs of clean and unclean animals, of birds and all the creatures that move along the ground, male and female, came to Noah and they entered the ark. Notice they came to him. He didn't have to go find them. Whew, would have taken like 200 years if that would have been the case. And he did this as God commanded in verse 10. And after the 7 days, the floodwaters came on the earth. Notice some of these details. In the 600th year of Noah's life, on the 17th day of the second month. What is this saying? It really happened. It's history. It's historical narrative. Here's the time and day. Here's where it happened. It's not just a story. It's historical. And notice this detail. On that day, God gives you a little hint here how he did it. The springs of the great deep burst forth, and the floodgates of the heavens were opened. This teaches us that the flood came from below and above. Verse 12, and rain fell on the earth 40 days and 40 nights. What we know about modern hydrology is that our environmental systems now could not produce water from the sky for 40 days and 40 nights. Our weather patterns don't work that way. It can't hold that much water. It doesn't work that way. Okay? So we know that the earth was different then, and something supernatural and cataclysmic happened. Let's keep reading. Genesis 7:17. For 40 days, the flood kept coming on the earth, and as the waters increased, they lifted the ark high above the earth. And the waters rose and increased greatly on the earth, and the ark floated on the surface of the water. They rose greatly on the earth, and all the high mountains under the entire heavens were covered. All the high mountains were covered. Wow, verse 20. The waters rose, and they covered the mountains to a depth of more than 15 cubits. Boy, that's a lot of detail, right, for a cute little kid story. Verse 21. Every living thing that moved on land perished. Birds, livestock, wild animals, and all the creatures that swarm over the earth. Now just, I want you to see grace in this story all the way through, because even when bad things were happening, just notice God killed all the mosquitoes. Can I get an amen? Everything that swarmed, praise Jesus. All of it. Everything that had the breath of life in its nostrils died. Every living thing on the face of the earth was wiped out. All of it. And it says only Noah was left and those with him in the ark. And the floodwaters hit the earth for 150 days. Total for the whole flood was about a year and a month when you put the entire event all together. So what do we know and believe about the flood? Here's a few things. Number one, the flood we believe was global. We believe, according to the scriptures, the flood was global. Let me give you a few reasons why we believe the flood was global. Because there's another choice that a lot of modern evangelicals are embracing. Because we're getting hit so hard on, man, you can't believe this stuff. It's too fantastic. It's too crazy. You can't believe that. But the problem is, if I can't believe God's powerful enough to suspend natural law to flood the earth, then I don't believe he can raise Jesus from the dead. Are y'all following me today? The question is, do I believe in supernatural, miraculous power from God? Do I believe he has power over creation? Do I believe he can do what he wants to do? And if the answer is yes, then I can believe in a global flood. But not only that, there's more. There's details that help us understand that there was something global that happened on the earth. But number one, we believe it's global first because the Bible tells us. We believe the Bible, right? And if we're going to read it the way it is, the Bible gives us no indication that this is a local flood. Many modern evangelicals are trying to say it was local. It was just a little flood in the Mesopotamian Valley, and that's the only part of the earth people knew, and that's what God did. And that fixes everything, so we don't have to believe in something so big and crazy. But that's not what the Bible teaches, okay? The Bible says that it was a global flood. Clearly, every mountain on earth covered, everything that swarms. Do you believe that there were, you know, if it was just the Mesopotamian Valley, then why does the Bible say that everything, including the swarms? I want the mosquitoes dead, man. The Bible says they died, all right? All of them, everything. You have to wonder, though, did two mosquitoes end up on the boat? I bet that was annoying. Noah's like, for real, did we need these, right? Second reason we believe that it was global and not local is if it was a local flood, then the ark was stupid. The ark was a colossal waste of time. If it was a local flood and not global, why didn't God say, Noah, I'm giving you a 120-year head start. Get your family and start walking and get out of the Mesopotamian Valley. Does that make sense? Why don't you just walk? Get out of there. Here's where I'm going to flood. It's going to be a local flood. I'm going to kill everybody because this is where they all live. You just go over here. You'll be fine. And he had 120 years. He built a boat for 120 years. I bet if they started walking, they would have gotten out of the way of the flood if it were local. So the ark is useless if it's not a global flood. Does that make sense? By the way, there's another time in the Bible where God was going to destroy someplace, and he told his folks to get out of there. Where was that? Sodom and Gomorrah. Remember that? He said, Lot, get out. Really? You want me to get out? Oh, yeah, get out. I'm about to destroy this place. Seriously? All of us? Get out and don't even look back. And one of them did look back, and you saw how that worked out, right? If you don't, just read the story. It's a great story. And it's true, too, because we believe the Bible. So what we see is that the Bible points to, and the whole point of the ark is that it was global. It was a global flood. And here's one of the big things I believe about it. The reason I believe the flood was global is because if it was a local flood, then God didn't tell the truth, did he now? Because didn't God tell Noah after this thing, I will never do this again, right? I'm never going to do this again. I'll destroy the earth again a different way, but I will not do this again. Well, if it was local, then y'all tell me, how many of you in this room know of, have experienced, have heard of, read about a local flood in your life? No one? Y'all never heard of a local flood? Y'all with me today? Hello, hello, hello. Calling, calling. Yeah, we've all heard of floods, right? Mississippi River floods, Mobile, Alabama floods every now and then. Hurricane comes in, it floods. There have been local floods on the earth since the days of Noah. Would you agree? So then if it's a local flood, God doesn't tell the truth. Now, how many of you believe God tells the truth? Then I have to believe in a global flood. Now, am I saying that, listen, if you disagree with this, we can still love Jesus. I'm just telling you what the Bible teaches. And I think that if I start messing with Genesis, then I'm going to have a hard time believing that he does the other stuff too. Where are we going to stop? If I give you your pair of scissors and you start cutting out the stuff you have a hard time believing, where are you going to end up? What are you going to cut out of there? Because if you take Jesus and the resurrection out of there, then we've got a problem. Right? I have to believe that God has the power to do this. So we believe that it was a global flood. And then Jesus and the apostles affirmed it. All the apostles and Jesus said over and over again in the Old Testament, Noah was real. He was a real man. It really happened. And it was true. Peter helps us understand what God's going to do one day by pointing to what he already did with Noah. Peter said, one day God's going to destroy the earth with fire like he did with water with Noah. Now, why would he make that comparison if it was a local flood or if it didn't really happen and it was just a story? So we see this in the scriptures. Next, the ark was large enough to hold the animal species of the earth. Now this is interesting because many people have a hard time. They're like, y'all are crazy. You can't put all the animals on the earth in a boat. I don't care how big the boat is. Well, I beg to differ. Number one, the Bible says species, not animals, which means you didn't have on the boat a cocker spaniel, a dachshund, a bird dog, a hound dog, a deer dog, a cow dog, a sheep dog, a shrimp dog. I'm just kidding. We don't have shrimp dogs. Maybe. You see what I mean? Species. That means the entire cow-type animals could have been represented with a boat, you know, one, bovine. The entire bovine group could have been taken care of there. Canines. Cats, which I still don't understand why they had to end up on there. I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding, cat lovers. That's just a little joke. That's a little joke. All right? So you have species. And you go, okay, well, still, Chris, I don't know how you can get them all on there. It's because most of us think that everything's as big as an elephant. You think everything's that size. But actually, the average size animal on planet Earth right now is somewhere between a small sheep and a really big cat. So let's just take sheep as an average, okay? Sheep is the average size of the species of animals on the face of the earth. The ark, number one, was big. The ark was 4 stories high. It was twice as high as the room you're sitting in, as wide as this room, and 4.5 times as long. That's how big the ark was. It was 1,396,000 cubic square feet. That's how much space was in the ark. Okay? That would hold, according to our estimate, which science backs us up, about the average size of a small sheep. If that is the species, then the ark could hold an estimated 7,000 species. Now you would go, okay, well that's not enough. Yes, it is. If you take the animal species on earth right now that are larger than a sheep, you end up with approximately 290 species. If you take animals between the size of a sheep down to a rat, you have about 757 species. If you take animals smaller than rats, and that's the biggest group, these little critters are taking over, okay? There are 1,359 of those species. Taken all together, you have approximately on Earth right now 2,500 species of animals. So maybe believing this stuff doesn't make you as dumb as you thought. Okay? The ark was big enough to hold the species of the earth and enough food and Noah's family. It was able to do it. Not to mention that God's pretty smart, and I bet he didn't send the biggest, fattest, tallest elephant that he could find to get on that ark. Right? I bet he found a little one. Let's take the little one over here. He's been doing his cardio. He's an off on the carbohydrates. We're putting him on the boat. All right? In fact, many theologians and biblical scientists believe that probably many of the animals were babies, were young. Makes sense, doesn't it? I bet God thought about that, right? You see what I'm saying? This is not as far-fetched as you think. In fact, it's not far-fetched at all. Next, we believe that the flood radically changed the earth and the atmosphere. The earth was a different place. Creation gave us the first earth. The flood essentially gave us the second earth, okay? Because it's so different. You had a tropical environment across the earth, and then afterwards, suddenly you have weather patterns, and you ended up with deserts and polar ice caps. You ended up with Antarctica and Mobile, Alabama, okay? You ended up with all these different environments. You ended up with higher mountain peaks, and you ended up with deeper oceans because the earth is now 70% of water. How did that happen? How did God flood the earth? Well, the Bible tells us that he did it by exploding the depths, the earth from the below, and the firmament fell in on the earth. Because we don't hear it mentioned in the scriptures anymore. We know now we can't live that long. We know now we don't have a stable environment. The earth changed. And the earth was made to look older than it ever was. Something happened on this earth and it changed things fast. And you go, well, I can't believe that. That's where you got me, bro. Well, let me give you an example. A modern example. I show you now on the screen Mount St. Helens. This is a beautiful mountain. They're going to put it up right now. And it's really pretty and it's in Washington State. But that's not a picture from today. That's a picture from the 1970s. Look at all those forests and woods and acres of timber and no telling what kind of incredible animals. Just a beautiful place. But in 1980, it exploded because that is a volcano and one of the largest eruptions that we know of in history. And I want you to see what happened in a matter of moments. Check it out.
The Mount St. Helens death toll included 6,000 black-tailed deer, 5,200 elk, 11 million fish, 27,000 grouse, 11,000 hares, 1,400 coyotes, 300 bobcats, 200 black bears, 15 mountain lions, and 57 people. Mount St. Helens blast wave traveled down the slopes at the speed of sound, flattening whole forests and blasting 600 tons of ash into the atmosphere. Pyroclastic flow, the scientists call it. It's the deadliest kind of eruption.
A lot of the danger in many of those eruptions is not actually the ash, it is hot gases that are coming out. And with the ash, they form a column, and it gets so dense that it collapses back on itself. And when it does that, it's falling down, and it has to go somewhere, and it goes out. And so there's a base surge of hot gases that flows along the ground surface, and it can move very, very rapidly. And that is what normally kills people fairly far from the volcano.
That is a picture of Mount St. Helens today, and that happened in moments. If you don't believe that God can radically change the earth quickly, just take a look at that. If you don't believe that something can look like it took billions of years to happen, and it only happened in a moment, then just go right around and see how that entire environment was changed in a moment. The scriptures seem to indicate that a Mount St. Helens type event happened worldwide, simultaneously, at the same moment, the depths of the earth were opened up and pressure and steam and water exploded out of the earth. What was watering and keeping a tropical environment on the earth came exploding out of the earth as the firmament literally crushed in on the earth, and we had a global flood that changed everything forever. And afterwards, the earth was different. Weather, frozen areas, overheated areas, unstable, hurricanes, tornadoes, on and on and on it goes. after the flood, we had a different environment. And lastly, write this down, there is an enormous amount of evidence for a global flood. Enormous. I'll just give you a few. You can go read about this stuff, but I'll just give you a few. I mean, how do you explain fish fossils and seashells in inland areas in the world like Colorado and West Virginia? What's a fish doing up there? How'd that happen, right? How do we find an elephant-type species frozen in tundra and in frozen areas? They live in the tropics. Why would he be up there? And why, when they found him frozen, and did they cut him open and find inside of him vegetation, green, leafy vegetation? How did that happen? Well, it happened because he was caught in an instant global catastrophe. The earth tells us that something big happened. And over again, it tells us this. If you look at the earth, science tells you something big happened. If we look at how the strata is dispersed across the earth, the geology, everything, something happened. And the Bible tells us what happened. Not to mention that today there are 270 people groups and tribes across the earth from different languages and different backgrounds. They look different. They live in different places. And they all have a flood story as a part of their history. They tell a flood story. And about 70% of them talk about a boat saving a family. And that's how the human race continued. Now you go, see, bro, that's why I don't believe it, because everyone made up this story. Really? That's how you take it? Because the way I take it is, that's actually proof that it really happened. That's actually proof that the entire human race was reset and re-began in Noah. Because here's the deal. When you have multiple reports of similar accuracy, doesn't that tend to make you believe that there may be truth in what's being said? Look, if one guy walks in here today, we're in Alabama, I'll give you an Alabama example. If a guy walks in here and says, hey man, there's a 12-point buck standing out in that field, I'm going to go, no, there's not. If two people come in, I'm going to go, okay, there's probably some kind of deer out there, it's not a 12-point buck. But if like 40 people come in and go, hey man, there's a 12-point buck standing in that field, guess what? There's a 12-point buck standing out in that field, right? That's how that works. 270 people groups tell similar story, just not with the pinpoint accuracy of Genesis. Something happened, guys, and the Bible tells us what? There is overwhelming evidence that the flood happened and that it was global. And this is where we come today. We shouldn't be surprised. Jesus told us in Matthew 5 that until heaven and earth disappear, not the smallest letter or least stroke of a pen will by any means disappear from the law. Jesus affirmed the Bible and he said it is true and it's all going to come true. Not only does it tell you what has happened that's true, Genesis, the Bible, Noah, the ark, the flood, but it tells you that it's true that it's going to happen again. God destroyed the earth once and he will do it again, and he'll do it exactly how he has said he will do it. But I want you to understand this. With all that science, God is more concerned with us understanding the why of the flood than the how. Write that down. God wants you to understand why more than how, because he didn't tell you all the how. There's tons of mystery. We don't know exactly how he did it. The Bible doesn't give you a play-by-play. It gives you one little sentence. The depths opened up and the floodgates of heaven opened up. And then we look at the clues of the Bible and we begin to put this together. Okay? Doesn't give you all the details. Because that wasn't his point. His point was for you to know him. His point was to reveal himself to you. And he wants you to know why he did it. And he told us, right? Genesis 6:12. Why did he kill everyone? Why did God flood the earth? Genesis 6 says, God saw how corrupt the earth had become, for all the people on earth had corrupted their ways. Write this down. God flooded the earth because of sin. Make no mistake. And he's not sentimental about it. Just know this. God is a loving God, but he's also a holy God. And he doesn't go, hey guys, I hate to do this, but I'm going to have to flood the earth. He never gets sentimental. He never apologizes. There's never even an apologetic tone in what God says in Genesis. Over and over again, he takes full credit for the flood and says, I did this, I did this, I did this. Why? Because he is fully, fully justified in doing it. A holy God destroying a rebellious people. And what this tells us, what does this reveal to us? See, man, it's awesome to talk about grace and love, and we should and we do, but you need to understand you will never appreciate the glory and wonder and beauty of grace if you don't understand that it came from a God that is also wrathful and full of judgment, and rightfully so, okay? When you look at the flood and you see how horrific it is, it should make you appreciate grace. Write this down. The flood was not a natural disaster. It was a supernatural judgment. It was supernatural in nature. It was cataclysmic. And it was judgment of sin. If you don't take sin seriously, take a look at the flood. If you want to see how deadly and lethal the anger and wrath and judgment of a holy God is, then read the story of the flood in the Bible and see how he reacts to sin. And then if you're a believer today, what you should do is you should turn the pages of your Bible after you look at how God takes care of sin in Genesis and keep turning until you get to the Gospels, and you'll end up on a little hill right outside of Jerusalem. And if you really want to see the lethal and brutal impact of the wrath of God, you look at his own perfect son hanging naked and tortured and bleeding on a cross, nailed to a tree, and crying out for mercy and not receiving any, and you will see the wrath and the anger of God. And may we all, when we look at it and remember the flood and remember Jesus, may we hit our knees and lift trembling hands and say, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for blocking the wrath of God from me, for being a canopy for me to run to, a shelter for me to run into, for taking that on yourself. The Son of God took the wrath of God for you and for me. And if you want to see how unbelievably crushing the wrath of God is, look at the flood. We don't take sin seriously, do we? We play around with it. We make jokes about it. We live in a culture that's looking more and more like Noah's day, right? We laugh at things that God abhors. We make jokes about things God hates. And I think we'd be remiss if we didn't look back into Genesis and go, wow, he takes it seriously. That's why Jesus said, if your hand causes you to sin, just cut it off. It'd be better to do that than end up in the hands of an angry God. God takes sin seriously. Three things the flood teaches us is, number one, God hates sin and he judges it. Make no mistake. You can't have God one way and not have him all the way. He is who he is. By the way, his judgment and wrath is good. Because if God, listen, how many of you know parents that threaten and threaten their kids and they never do anything? Don't they drive you nuts? Right? If you're that parent, I'm sorry. I love you in Jesus' name. But please stop acting like you're going to actually discipline your kid when you don't. Bobby, if you do that one more time now, don't do it again. Stop it, Bobby. Stop, Bobby. Bobby. Bobby, stop. Mommy's going to, you know. And we're all going, please stop, and we'll handle it for you. Just let us handle it for you. Right? God's not like that. See, we're imperfect. God's not. God doesn't threaten and then not come through. God told Noah, 120 years. They have 120 more years to turn to me. They did not. And then Jesus, in Isaiah, God said through Isaiah, he said, I'm coming. I'm coming in human flesh. And I will take sin upon myself, and my body will be bruised. And I will take pleasure to crush my own son. I will pour out my wrath. Grab this. God has never ignored sin. You need to know that. He didn't ignore yours. Salvation is not an ignoring of your sin. Every sin that has ever been committed has been accounted for. Every sin God punishes. How? He did it in Jesus on a cross for you and I. God hates sin and he judges it. Number two, he has power over his creation. He tells two of each, get on the boat, and they come. He has power. And then lastly, what does the flood teach us? Man, it teaches us grace and salvation are amazing gifts. Would you agree with that today? Isn't grace amazing when you look at the flood and you go, look at what God kept from me. Look at what Jesus did for me. Grace is amazing. Salvation is amazing. But you can't appreciate it without seeing the full measure of the wrath of God. Any good painter or artist knows that contrast is powerful, right? I can use color to contrast another color and make something even more beautiful. And many of us have heard all of our lives how loving God is, and he is, more than you could imagine. But we've never looked at his wrath. And it's why many of us don't fully appreciate his love and grace. May the flood be a reminder today of that. His grace. Genesis 6:18, in the middle of all of it, he told Noah, I will establish a covenant with you and you'll enter that ark. Write it down. God is a God of judgment and grace. As we close today, let me remind you, out of all that wrath, remember, the earth is now covered in water, it's flooded. But if you looked from the heavens real close through all of that deluge, you would see on the surface of the waters a little 450 feet long box. If you listen real close, you might hear, because there's cows on there. And cows is the only animal noise I can make, so that's the best I can do. Grace. All this wrath, and there it is, grace. There it is, floating, one little family. And you can look at all of the absolute evil and wickedness that is poured out on this earth that we have brought upon ourselves. You look at all of it and you see the warnings in the Bible of wrath. But 2,000 years ago, if you looked from the heavens close enough, if you could have flown a plane over it, you would have seen a little speck, two wooden beams. You may have even heard a cry. Why have you forsaken me? You would have heard him scream it out. And then you would have seen him die. Grace. In the middle of all the deluge, there it is. Grace, 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 grace. And the only way I can appreciate that is to realize just how big this was, this thing that I was saved from. Okay? Now, what do we do with this today? Well, a few things. I want you to see that you can trust the Bible, and I want you to take sin seriously, and I want you to appreciate grace. Those three things. I want you to start taking sin seriously because God did. May we never play with something that God destroyed the earth over. Okay? Number two, I want you to appreciate his grace and be thankful. Love him. Love Jesus. Be grateful for what he did. But lastly, I want you to believe the Bible and obey it. And we've given you some tools to do that. If you look in your handout, there is a link to this Bible study tool. Now, you can also pick one up, I do believe, at our resource center. We have a few of them. It's Rick Warren's Bible Study Methods. I love this. I use this personally, and it's really good. If you want to learn how to study the Bible better, how to handle the Bible better, pick this book up. You can either get it online or you can pick it up today as you leave. Really, really great. And then this is kind of new. This is cool. It's called a journal. And what you do is you go through the Bible and you write out the scriptures that you're reading. And there's something about the cognitive effect of that that helps you memorize and learn the Bible. And I really want to encourage you to do that, to take this and really learn and really read the Bible, okay? These are the tools we want to put in your hand. You can buy one of these at our resource center before you leave today. So these are just some tools to help you get into the Bible because, man, it is really, really awesome. Now, how many of us today here at Three Circle are thankful for Jesus? Are you thankful for Jesus? Well, let's pray. Jesus, thank you for your word. Thank you for your truth. And thank you that you gave your life, became a ransom for us. Thank you that you took care of this for us. We fall to our knees with trembling hands and we thank you. And thank you that we can trust your word, that you are fully trustworthy. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.